sinais, sendendo a luz, almas suas, acendendo na noticina, sendendo a luz, almas suas, acendendo na noticina, sendendo
a luz.
Sonela, si sonela.
Thank you. It seemed to be one. Many lives have passed away, and in many homes there are voices crying now to the from the heaven above, and when lips they move by grace, they so sweet for peace in Africa, from the
thanks a lot, indeed. God bless Africa. In our midst, we are also joined by the keynote speaker, Professor Samba Morimbop. We acknowledge your presence, greetings, and you're more than welcome. Asibonga, Prof. And we would also like to greet our panel of judges that are looking very nice. I hope Chris will take them a nice picture. Colleagues, as you may know, that it is a tradition at the University of Mpumalanga that we celebrate Africa Day, but we're not doing it for the sake of doing it. We're doing it taking into consideration of where the university is located, in pursuit of its vision that of an African university leading in creating opportunities for sustainable development through innovation. So we have this event in that context. And all these things that we do, they do not just happen. They happen because there's a leadership that is leading from the front to ensure that we truly live up to our aspirations of being an African university. And that leadership is led none by other than Professor Tokoma Yegiso, who's our Vice Chancellor. We'd like to request now that she comes to the podium to give us a welcome address.
Sanbonani, Dumelang, Arsheni, Loshani, Dimasiare, Molweni. Good afternoon. Goeiemiddag. Namaste. I hope I would have been able to add the greetings from the six countries we're celebrating today. But I hope that after the presentations by the students, we will all know how to greet in a language in Morocco, in Rwanda, etc. It is indeed an honor and a privilege for me to welcome all of you to the Africa Day celebrations, those attending in person and those attending virtually. A special word of welcome to our guest speaker, Professor Samba Mbope. We are honored to have you, Prof, as our guest speaker today. Welcome to members of MENCO, IMENCO, staff, students, SRC. This year, our celebrations will focus on six African countries, namely Morocco, Senegal, Kenya, Rwanda, Democratic Republic of Congo, and Lesotho. MENCO members selected a country that they would showcase. So maybe let me ask Dr. Maminza to stand as he is showcasing Kenya. Thank you, Paul. Dr. Govender, Morocco. Professor Samas, Senegal. Dr. Chikwatamba, Morocco. So you can see that we're taking Africa Day very seriously at MENCO. Africa Day is a day of great salience to the continent and its people. It is essentially an annual commemoration on 25th May of the founding of the Organization on African Unity in 1963. On this day, leaders of 32 independent African states signed a founding charter in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. In 1991, the OAU established the African Economic Community, and in 2002, it established its own successor, the African Union, which means that this is now 20-year celebration. Many of us would not forget the impassioned speech by former President Mbeki, where he truly and passionately celebrated the continent. His opening words were, "I am an African. I owe my being to the hills and valleys, the mountains and glades, the rivers, the deserts, the trees, the flowers, the seas, and the ever-changing seasons that define the face of our native land." Africa Day, therefore, is a celebration of African unity. At the same time, it creates a platform for us as Africans to reaffirm our commitment to work in partnership with other Africans to realize our potential by nurturing an environment that is conducive to prosperity, democracy, and peace. Africa Day, in the South African context, provides African brothers and sisters from all over the continent an opportunity to get to understand and appreciate one another. It provides us with an opportunity to distance ourselves from xenophobia and all the evils associated with it. We deny our own humanity if we treat others differently because they come from another country, and worse, if they come from another province within South Africa. As the UMP community, we embrace and celebrate our connectedness to the African continent in our very own vision. We state we would like to position ourselves to be an African university, leading in creating opportunities for sustainable development through innovation. We believe that Africa Day provides us with an excellent opportunity to advance our vision and as well as our values, in particular, the value for diversity. We are establishing a tradition of celebrating Africa Day annually since 2015. We have been fortunate to be able to invite great scholars to reflect with us on our great continent. This is a clear message that we value and embrace our African identity, our Africanness. UMP, as an African university, seeks to recognize, to affirm, and entrench the African experience and context in the academic project. The vision prompts us to have a keen interest in what happens on the continent and really be passionate about playing our role properly to ensure that the continent succeeds. We all know that education is critical to development. We have to continue to work hard towards the economic transformation of our continent. My invitation is to students and staff alike to use these platforms to educate ourselves about Africa. An eminent scholar in the person of Professor Samba will be addressing us today. Please make use of this opportunity to learn. May this address trigger interest in all of us who are on this continent to advance knowledge, skills, and competencies that will develop our continent further. When, as the UMP community, we live up to all the values we hold dear, especially excellence, we can begin to impact and transform the continent. As we celebrate Africa Day, let us take this opportunity to reflect on the value of Ubuntu. Let us reflect on our humaneness, our Africanness, and realize that umntu ngumntu ngabantu. We are interconnected and interdependent. Enkosi.
Thanks a lot, Vice Chancellor Professor Maikiso, for the welcome address. This is indeed the day of African unity, a day that gives us an opportunity. And possibly we can repeat that, an opportunity to learn about affairs of the continent, to learn from one another and be tolerant and embrace each other as Africans. So we really appreciate the message, Prof. I'll now request the Dean of the Faculty of Economics, Development and Business Sciences, Professor Vusi Kumede, to come and introduce our keynote speaker.
Thanks, Program Director. Greetings, everyone. I'd like to acknowledge the Management Committee, including or especially the Vice Chancellor and Principal of the University, Professor Maikiso, and also to acknowledge those that are attending virtually, and our colleagues and students. It's an honor to introduce Professor Samba Buri Bop, one of our outstanding Pan-Africanists. You'll agree with me when he's done with his speech that he is indeed one of those that we should be proud of. He's talking to us about issues that are very close to the hearts of all of those who deeply care about Africa and Africans, wherever they are. We should indeed celebrate our common humanity, our common Africanity and Ubuntu, as the Vice Chancellor indicated. These are issues that many of the torchbearers and luminaries who demonstrated that Africa and Africans are indeed interconnected. I think here of Cheikh Ada Diop, the work that he did with Théophile Obenga, and maybe Prof. Bob was going to talk to that. And of course, many others later on who've taken this forward. Danina Budere in particular comes to mind. Our own Achima Feje in South Africa, particularly in relation to Africanity, then in relation to Africology, Maureen Kalenga, and many others who've been pursuing Afrocentricity, and to mention also Molefeke Asante, who's been here at the university previously, and Amama Zama, who also does work on this. Prof. Samba Buri Bop was educated in Senegal and in France. He studied at the historical Dakar-based Cheikh Ada Diop University and at Sorbonne University in France, in Paris. Prof. Mbop holds a doctorate in general and comparative literature. He has two diplomas, one in Swahili and one in Bantu languages and civilization. He speaks French, English, Portuguese, Spanish, as well as Wolof, his mother tongue, and of course, Swahili. The languages are extremely important, as I think he's going to talk to us about that, as the program director alluded to that, and many others, Professor Kwesi Kwa-Prime, who work on the languages, who emphasize this importance of languages and how actually our languages are related, which also confirms what Cheikh Ada Diop and many others demonstrated many, many years back in the 30s and the 40s, that we are effectively, we are one people as Africans. He is a founding member of the Thabo Mbeki African Leadership Institute, now the Thabo Mbeki African School of Public and International Affairs. He's widely published, including an important book on gender, which is in Portuguese though. So if you want to read it, but he should translate it. He translates books as well. And of course, several book chapters and peer-reviewed journal articles in the themes such as linguistic and cultural anthropology, development studies, gender, leadership, African Renaissance, and Pan-Africanism. He was an associate professor at the University of South Africa. Prof. Mope served as an ambassador of Senegal to Southern Africa and the Indian Ocean during 2001 and 2006 before he joined or rejoined the academic sector. He has been involved with various initiatives aimed at Pan-African unity, including as a member of the NEPAD Steering Committee, as a NEPAD resource person, as an African Union expert in the areas of education and governance. And I must mention this, maybe you'll disagree with me, but the Pan-African Federalist Movement, amongst others. His research and activist profile include strategic studies, linguistic and cultural anthropology, research methodology, with a focus on Africology. I think I'm not going to continue. The list is very long, Prof. I just want to highlight as I close that amongst the most important things that Prof. Pope has done was to co-translate. He was one of the translators of the timeless book by Walter Rodney, How Europe Underdeveloped Africa. This was in 1986. This is a book I argue everyone should read. Walter Rodney's How Europe Underdeveloped Africa. May I please request you, Prof. Mbof, to come forward and give your lecture. Thank you.
Can I move the mics a little bit? Good. You can start maybe projecting this. Asante sana, Professor Toko Mayekiso, kwa kunikaribisha hapa leo katika chuo cha kikuu cha Mpumalanga. Pia na shukuru Professor Vusi Gumede, ambaye ni ndugu yangu, rafiki yangu, ni mwenzangu. Pamoja na profesa wote wa chuo kikuu cha Mpumalanga na wafanyakazi wote kama Sitembiso, Nokwazi Patients, ambao walijaribu sana kwa kuniletea hapa. Wote, asanteni sana, niabonga kakulu. Translation, I think. Thank you so much. Greetings and thank you, Professor Mayekiso, Toko Mayekiso, as the Vice Chancellor, for inviting me here. It's a great privilege and honor. Thank you also, my brother, friend, and fighting a companion in the trenches of academia when we were both at UNISA, Professor Vusi Gumede. Thank you to all the workers and the staff members like Sitembiso, Nokwazi patients who have worked hard to bring me here. To all, thank you very much. I have dedicated this talk, this lecture, to a friend of mine called Brian Scott, who originated from Sabi, and whom, although he passed on in 2008, still is my best friend. So you can imagine how much I miss him and how emotional I feel to be a milestone from Sabi, where he has invited me together with my family, treated us like kings and queens. His family is here. So if you allow me, I would recognize the presence of Antoinette, his eldest daughter, Antoinette. Carlo, his son, and Andrew, another son, and his other brother. So thank you very much for coming. It's really a pleasure. Now, starting the business of the day, listening to the list of the speakers who have preceded me, I am tempted to do like one of my uncles, who was a politician but a very bad speaker. So what he would do is to send first his assistant, heat up the whole hall, and after that he would come and say, "All that I wanted to say has been said by my assistant." But I know that you would not allow me to have traveled so far and made so many efforts, to get away with that. So I will have to say something. So thank you very much, Professor. So this is the team that I will be speaking to. This place is a little better. We will try. So this is Brian. If you can show the pictures of Brian. Yeah, so this is him. There is the second one with his family. Can I turn this in order to, do you mind if I stay to, or should I stick to this? Okay, so it's fine. You can, yes, this is his spouse, Shuman, and his children that I have mentioned. And the last picture, that is when Madiba came to visit their enterprise. They have a family enterprise of trucks and So this is a family, and that is one thing also that tied us as Pan-Africanists, that has contributed also, that has paid its due to the liberation struggle. So even before Mandela, before the elections of 1994, April 1994, Mandela went there just to say thank you. And there was even an incident, if you allow me, because his son, Carlo is here. Carlo had a gift for Mandela, and he says, "Go and get it. Let me go and get it." But the security just jumped on him, But it's really a pleasure to think of Brian, to pay tribute to his legacy and to his memory. You can move on to the, okay, so this is the outline. I will not comment it. As we go, I will speak to it, but quickly, because we don't have time. So if you allow me, maybe I would move a little bit, Prof, because I don't have enough space. I am afraid, it will be a little bit cumbersome. So if you allow me, I will not turn my back, but I will look at the slides. Okay, next, please. Okay, the origins of Africa Day, of course, you have mentioned it, Prof. You know, we owe the idea to Osage for Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. You know, as a day on which African people, those at home and abroad to speak like Max Garvey, would meet, celebrate themselves, their Ubuntu, their commonness, reflect on their common destiny and how to plan and strategize to take, to recapture back into our hands the historical initiative that was taken away from us. Oh, yeah. Thank you so much. So I can stay even here? It's better. Thank you. Okay, next. So in Kiswahili, I would wish you a happy Africa Day of unity and for liberation and unity. Next. Now, when we talk of Africa Day, we are talking of the stake. When we reflect, we are reflecting on what is the stake of this day. And the stake of this day is to recover our sovereignty, because we have lost our sovereignty. And we will see that loss of sovereignty is one of the major issues that we are facing, and issues of leadership, etc. But we will speak to that. Next, please. The significance of Africa Day. Africa Day is a landmark in a chain of interconnected struggles through space and time on the continent, outside the continent, that is marked, and it is important to underline that, marked by the permanence of resistance of our people against oppression. That is important because the dominant discourse tend to present us as a passive people, but we will see that we have always been struggling against oppression, and we have won, and I will speak to that as well, because our history is also a history of great achievements and victories. Next. Now, of course, I have to run some time, so I don't talk to the difficult consensus between the two groups, you know, the Casablanca group, you know, and the Brazzaville, then Monrovia group, et cetera, et cetera. So let us carry on. So talking of Africa is talking first about a huge continent. So within, you know, this map, I think everybody knows it. So within Africa, you can put the USA, China, India, almost, you know, the rest of the world, and they will still have some space. So huge continent, next. And this can be exemplified, not when you look at the world as represented in the classical Mercator projection, the map that we know, which is a false map. It does not represent the real proportions. If we look, for instance, at the former USSR as compared to Africa, we have the impression the former USSR is bigger than Africa, right? It is not. Just look at the figures in terms of actual land masses. Africa is 8.7, no, the Soviet Union is 8.7 million square miles as against 11.6 million square miles. And this does not reflect in this map. So this is, and this does not come as a, by chance. It is done on purpose. There is a book written by a French author, Yves Lacoste. The title is, "The Use of Geography is to Make Warfare." Yeah, first generals, he's right, because generals need to have some knowledge in geography, cartography, you know, pedology, etc., but also in human geography. That is why the censuses are a very delicate issue, but also the representation of the world. So we are really in warfare, and we have to be very conscious of that, because sometimes we tend to be a little bit, you know, lenient and, you know, and lack the vigilance that we deserve, because nobody has done us any favor. and nobody will do us any favor. Anything that we are going to have, we'll have to fight for it. Next. So in terms of population, Africa today, you know, is almost 1.5 billion of inhabitants. And to those who try to tell us that we are too many Africans, we should make less babies or even stop making babies. And sometimes they help us, you know, they help our women to make less babies. Demography, as Mao Tse-tung has said and has demonstrated, demography, when managed adequately, can be a powerful tool for development and progress and social progress. So in terms of volume, you see it, Africa, this was in 2019, the projections, 1.2 billion. But not only in terms of volume, but the demographic profile. Africa has a young population, whereas other parts of the world generally, if not all of them, have a predominantly age or aging population. So having a young population as part of the demographic profile is very important. It only needs to be managed adequately. Okay, these are some of the estimates. And we will, according to these estimates, this is a work that was done by Professor Ujo as a contribution to a future studies that was recommended to me by the South African Department of International Relations and Cooperation, you know, the policy analysis department under Ambassador Genge, Maneliso Genge. This contribution on demographic was from Professor Ujo. Next. So these are some of the questions, you know, challenges, et cetera, including the impact, how to manage the impact of COVID pandemic, et cetera, et cetera. Next. Resource base, that is known. I mean, you know, Africa as a resource base. I don't think that I am going to spend too much time here. So let us pass. Let's say that Africa has a rich resource base that has served not only Africans, but also, and sometimes more so, you know, the rest of humanity for reasons that we know and that we also need to address, you know, when we are talking of repositioning strategically our continent, because this is what African Renaissance is, and that is what Africa Day is also all about. Next. All of this is known, I think. I would not bother you. If you want to waste time, you can come back during the discussions and look at some of these slides. So let's move. Contributions to science. Yes, Africa has contributed to science. First, as a cradle of humankind and human civilization. Generally, people agree now. Nobody dares dispute the fact that Africa is a cradle of humankind. But they like to forget the second component, that Africa is also the cradle of human civilization. So it is important to bear that in mind, and we will speak to that. But also through our contributions through space and time to building the wealth of nations and to advancing knowledge, science, and technology. Next. Now, Africa's role in World War II. One of the primary uses, yes, of geography is to make war. Next. And it shows in the role Africa has played, because Africa is at the center of the world map. It's a strategic location, extremely important. And actually, the outcome of World War II, despite, of course, contributions of decisive battles like the Battle of Stalingrad, but the outcome of the war was decided on African soil with the defeat of the German Afrika Korps under the command of General Rommel by the Allied forces commanded by General Montgomery and with the support of General Dwight D. Eisenhower. It is with those victories that the battle the World War outcome was decided over. Actually, when we look at, you can move. When we look at the military strategy of somebody like Winston Churchill, he made it very clear that Africa, and particularly North Africa, would be decisive right from the beginning. And many strategists saw it from the beginning. Because first, it would allow to open up the route to India. And secondly, the epicenter at the war at some point was around the Mediterranean. Hence the importance, the geopolitical and geostrategic importance of North Africa. Many Africans, of course, shed their blood, as members of European armies. And in 1943, Africans from French-dominated Western Equatorial Africa made up more than half of the total of the Free French Army. Next. Logistic backing, strategic refuge. Africa was not only a resource to provide men to go and fight, but also to produce the foodstuffs to nourish the battling armies on the ground. So at some point, Brazzaville was the capital. Brazzaville in Congo was the capital of De Gaulle's Free French government in exile. This is a reality. Whereas, this is also a fact that is not well known, the gold reserves of the Banque de France, of the National Bank of France, were kept not on European territory during the war, but in the city of Kai in Mali. That's very important. There is a story about how all of this was done. Next. Yes, Morocco also participated in the war at the request of General de Gaulle. In Casablanca, there was a meeting in 1938 between His Excellency Mohammed V, so the King, de Gaulle, Roosevelt, Churchill, General Henry Giraud, etc. But also a fact is that when de Gaulle of France from exile had made his appeal, to free France, to join forces, to remobilize, etc., the first one to respond positively to that appeal was Governor Félix Eboué, who was a governor of Equatorial Africa with residence in Chad. Next. Yeah, so Africa has been a continent of geostrategic stake and a theater. To finish with this, while Europe and Asia and North America were drawn into full-scale war between 1939 and 1941, in Africa, the war had started earlier, in 1935, with the invasion of Ethiopia by fascist Italy. Next. Okay. Talking about Africa and the African people is also talking about Africanity or Africanness. Professor? With reference to what I call Africanisms and African Africa. Next. Africanity, according to a broad definition, we can define Africanity as the traits and characteristics that make it possible to identify, define, or characterize as African every fact, reality, or any person or community. It can designate origin, the state, the identity, the essence, the nature of the facts, the citizenship, etc., etc. According to Pate Gyan, who is my professor and friend, Africanity must be understood in terms of a historical and cultural specificity and not in terms of racial specificity. That is very important. Although the color of our skin has been and is still used by others in order to discriminate and oppress us. It does not exclude, quite the contrary, possibilities of borrowing or mutual exchange with other cultures or areas of civilization. Next. Yes, so it's all historical experiences. When we talk of Africanisms, we are talking of the historical experiences and societies, as well as the cultural areas of space of spaces of civilization that can be identified in time and space on the continent and outside Africa, and then that we can identify as being part of African identity. Next. Next. Yes, the permanence of resistance against oppression, the resilience or endurance of our people. Here, I would like to pause and delve a little bit on the experience of the Fighting Maroons of Jamaica. These are independent communities that were located in the most inaccessible places and that were defended with a science of war, knowledge of strategy and military tactics that we can still learn from. Among these communities, we have the Fighting Maroons of Jamaica from the Cockpit Country in Jamaica, for those who know Jamaica, the Aucanisi, the Njuka, the Saramaka, the Matavai, the Quinti of Suriname, of Guyana, the Boni. It's as if we are saying the Tosa, the Zulu, you know. These are communities, and actually they keep it unto themselves until today. There is an example. The ambassador of Ghana to Cuba went to visit one of those communities. They call them their Cimarrones. So the ancient people started speaking, you know, practicing certain rituals in a language that sounded like one of the languages from Ghana, one of the Akan languages. And actually he made a recording, and when he went back, since he was not very, very conversant or very, you know, a very good speaker of his language, then the older people of his community translated exactly. It means that there is part of our heritage that is still preserved in the diaspora. And sometimes there are traits that have disappeared from the continent that we can find, including phenotypes, people, the way people look like, that have disappeared because of the genocide and that are kept within those independent communities. And among them, some, you know, the sizes are different. The duration of these communities, because the plantation, the plantocratic system of slavery, of enslavement was against them, these all means. So some have disappeared, but some have lasted. And one of them is the Republic of Palmares, the Black Republic of Palmares in Brazil, that resisted during more than one century against a political military coalition of European powers. And of course, we have Rastafari that Walter Rodney in the Groundings with My Brothers has labeled as one of the strongest and most genuine expressions of Pan-Africanism in the 20th century. He was writing in the 20th century. Next. And of course, now, next. Now, come back. Come back. Okay, don't worry. Since we are here, it is fine. Of course, Haiti. We have heard of Haiti that proclaimed its independence after defeating militarily the French and plantocratic army and proclaimed their independence on the 1st of January in 1804 and had to defend it militarily. There were six expeditions, one of them commanded by the brother-in-law of Napoleon of France, and they were defeated. They could not reconquer them. Not only that, but Haiti, as an independent state, created under the circumstances that I have just mentioned, contributed to the liberation of the rest of America. North America, there are proofs, but South America, Simon Bolivar, you have heard of Simon Bolivar. Simon Bolivar went twice to Haiti to request support from Alexandre Pétion, who was the second president, head of state, and the Haitian generals. They gave him, you know, boats, they gave him advisors, they gave him arms, etc., etc. Unfortunately, he did not fulfill his promise to fight. Because when he asked the second time, the first time he asked, what do you expect in return? Pekyon said, nothing. We are doing it. It's our duty of solidarity. The second time he told him, wherever you go, if the Bolivarian revolution is successful, you have to fight for the freedom, for the liberation of African people who are there kept into bondage. But Bolivar never kept that. Okay, let's close that parenthesis and move on. So African Africa, this is a concept that I was bold enough to create myself. What it means is Africa that is still itself. Africa that continues abiding by its own principles, value systems, etc. Now let's be careful. It is not only nor essentially an Africa of the past. It is also an Africa of today. There are things that go, institutions, value systems, you know, principles of life, of governance, etc. If we have time, we can give examples that relate directly from that African institutional and cultural heritage. So African Africa, it's not a return to the past. It is the past as a recourse or the resource that we can get inspiration from. In a critical manner, the things that are negative in our legacies, in our culture, and there are, like in any other cultures, let's get rid of them. The others positive, and there are many, 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 many more that unfortunately we don't know of, you know, that we can use as a source of inspiration in order to plan and build our future. So it is also an operational concept, African Africa. In my teaching, in my research, I use it as an operational concept for research for knowledge production. Move next. Within African Africa, there is a specific conception of knowledge in a context whereby a distinction exists between the superficial knowledge and on the deep or in the deep or inner knowledge, which is assumed to be co-substantive to scientific knowledge, so true knowledge. It is recognized to the old man or woman bending under the weight of years of accumulated experience and acquired wisdom, the faculty of seeing very far away, whereas the adolescent standing on her or his tiptoes stays blindly at the horizon. So there is a distinction between superficial and deep knowledge. And what makes the difference here is the wisdom, the capacity to manage knowledge. We say in Africa that knowledge is too heavy for the head of the dog. It means that if you use knowledge in an appropriate way, then that knowledge is almost lost or deviated from its purpose, because knowledge must be useful. Next. Yes, next. Yeah, the importance of the symbolic structures like religion, like language, spirituality, the images of self and other. And here we should go back to what Koto Esome has called in a series of articles that were published in Science et Vie, to the lost identities. We need to revisit what Dr. John Garang de Mabior from South Sudan called the corridors of history, to rediscover the geography, the lost geography of soils and people. You know, the route, the trading routes, the routes of historical migrations, etc., that are underneath our feet. We need to make an effort. Spaces like the University of Sankore, which at its time in Tombuctu in Mali was more advanced, had an educational system more advanced than most universities in the world. Or the Empire of Mali, by the way, which between the 13th and the 15th century, at the times of its peak, covered a superficie more extensive than three times today's France, the lost geography of soils and peoples. Next. Yes, we need to use here. You can come back, please, to the students. It is important to make use of the 9 volumes of the General History of Africa. It has been published. It is there. This is knowledge. This is true knowledge. This is deep knowledge produced from an interdisciplinary perspective and methodology. So I'm sure that you can find them. Whoever does not have it, you can have it. You can Google it. I have a copy. Eventually, I can leave it to anybody who wants. I can share it with you. Read it. It's very important to know better about yourselves, about African Africa. Okay, the global context. These are dimensions of globalization. Just move to the next slide. When we look at the, before speaking of African Renaissance, we have to position it in the global context of a world civilization that is still dominated by conflicting national interests. Despite all the noise about globalization, this is an era dominated by conflicting national interests and by nationalism, and whereby issues of military security and safety are a precondition for development. And also where the harnessing of scientific knowledge, of information, of technology plays an important role. So this is the context in which we are going to have a look at African Renaissance. Let's move. We can come back to that. So in this context, Africa is facing a number of challenges. One of them is non-viable nation or nation state and non-viable states, which is an alien model, which is alienating, oppressive, etc., characterized by what Mwaila Chiembe calls imported judicial positivism, meaning the establishment of norms and voting of laws without bothering to implement them. That is judicial positivism, but also by dual structuralism, meaning that we have at least 2 spaces, the traditional African space, African-African space, and the official one. And generally, they don't correspond, and even they conflict. That is one of the problems that we have. Next. So crisis of the nation state. Next. And this is very important, leadership crisis. If we look at African situation, all the problems that we have in health, education, transport, you name them, you can refer them back to one problem, the issue of leadership or the lack of leadership. Because Africa's main problem, I think, is that we are very rich in rulers and very poor in leaders. And we know that a ruler is not a leader, is not a ruler. Next. So leadership crisis, too many rulers, very few leaders. We need then, we will come back to this when we speak of the solutions. We need to identify and empower generations of leaders. We need to build institutions with adequate programs, etc. Next. So all the challenges, we are talking of leadership, but also the lack of sovereignty, issues of safety and security, lack of unity, and all of those are interrelated. Next, please. Hence, African Renaissance as Africa's organized response to all of these challenges. So what is African Renaissance? African Renaissance is an alternative global project of society and civilization aiming at the creations of conditions, objective and subjective, for the renaissance of our continent as an independent space, as a mature, as a competitive space of decision making in the world of today and tomorrow. But African Renaissance means also 2 other things. It is the objective, the long-term goal, as well as the process of transformation that will allow us to reach that goal. And talking of transformation is talking first and foremost about self-transformation of the people that we are. Otherwise, we will not be in a position to reach it. Next, the stakes, material development of African societies, collective security, social, human safety, but also cultural renaissance. I insist on cultural renaissance, synonymous of psychological healing, moral regeneration, and spiritual upliftment, healing. But to heal, we must recognize that we are sick. But as Joy DeGruy Leary in her book, Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome, has demonstrated, I'm sure that Prof is very familiar with that, has demonstrated there is a significant difference between not being sick and being in good health. Think about that. Next. So security and safety, next. We have to build an African protective shield. We have to review the state model, nation building, next. Now, within that, Africa presents itself, and this is almost a consensus among the analysts, presents itself as the new frontier, as a continent of the future. But I put it under question mark because it depends on how we are going to harness the different potentialities, opportunities that are ahead of us. So Africa is a continent where economic growth rates and levels of profitability of productive investments are the highest, among the highest in the world. We could also harness, we need to harness its demographic weight and its demographic profile. We have spoken to that. Its natural resource potential that is still considerable despite the plundering, and a remarkable margin of progress that, according to analysts, leaves open the possibility for a country like Nigeria to rank in 2050 alongside other countries such as Mexico and Indonesia among the group of the top 10 economies globally, surpassing countries such as the UK and France. Next, please. Okay, there are issues of infrastructure and productive factors. Very quickly, infrastructure we needed, and heavy infrastructure, not only social, but essentially developmental infrastructure. You know, the roads, the airports, you know, the bridges, ICT, etc., energy, you know, but also capital, you know, financial and industrial capital. These are productive factors alongside others. We need also to recapture, you know, the possession of our land and of our wealth, you know, as an important and fundamental productive factor. Next, all of this, you can go. Okay, the Africa Free Trade Zone. Next, this is just, you know, the FTA. It has just been launched, but okay, the first, this is the components, you can move. We all know about it. Next. Okay, the process of ratification is important. Next. Yes, establishment entry into force. Also, you can move. Now, opinions. There are different opinions about the possibility of the Africa Free Trade Zone. One thinks that it is a deal, is that it is vital for growth and job creation. Another one is the case of Jacques Berthelot, who is a friend from Belgium, an agroeconomist, believes that the CFTA is far from promoting regional integration of the continent because it will be profitable more to foreign companies that still dominate production sector, you know, instead of the Africans. So if you have to trade, you have to trade what you produce. If you are trading something that others produce, then you are going nowhere. Next. Okay, according to Ndongo Samba Silla, a brilliant young economist from Senegal, these are a few fast track measures that he suggests could help Africa take advantage of the creation of this free trade. One, need for a common policy for food, energy self-sufficiency, and infrastructure. Infrastructure again, rail, roads, ICT, etc. Secondly, to develop, promote Pan-African companies as a tool to gain economic sovereignty or to regain economic sovereignty. Not only South African or Senegalese or Congolese companies, no, Pan-African companies. And it is possible if the political will is there. Efficient agricultural sector, that is the third recommendation. Good income that will produce also good income together with other activities. A common policy for beneficiation of raw materials is important. Job creation program, issuance of debt securities, coordinating mechanism to reduce the cost of debt. Next, Africa needs an economic model. All the continents that have emerged and imposed themselves, you know, the tigers, Asian tigers, for instance, you know, Japan, etc. Everybody needs to have its economic model. I will speak to that in the discussions. Next. So the economic model must be a productive address, the productive hiccups, but also the consumption. We need a consumption model that goes with the productive model. And here, cultural renaissance, synonym of the reform of systems of education, of information. Information, we consume information, you know, from outside, not information produced by us, including the image of us that is projected, that is suicidal. We cannot allow that to happen. So we need to reform and repossess our informational system, but also our belief systems. We need to reform them, to revisit them. Next, linguistic decolonization is very important because it is in European languages that our elites or our rulers have inherited political power, manage it, and still stick to it. That is one. Whereas, second, in Africa, that is called Francophone, Anglophone, Saxophone, even saxophone will come. The reality, the sociolinguistic reality is that 70% of at least sub-Saharan Africa speak as mother tongue or at mother tongue proficiency level an African language. And these languages, like other languages, if they are developed, if the efforts are made, can be used as languages for science, you know, for knowledge, for governance, etc. And this is next. This is the linguistic map. We will come back to it if we have time. You know that it is important to see that all the languages that are listed here, except the Semitic that you see in yellow and Malagasy, that is in green, Madagascar, all the other languages are related. These are foreign languages, the Semitic, meaning Arabic, and Tigrinya and Amharinya. I'm not saying that the people who speak them are foreign to Africa. I'm not saying that. In terms of structure, of grammar, you cannot relate them to other African languages. Whereas all other African languages are related genetically. Prof. Gumede, you mentioned Sheikh Anta Diop, that is one of his contributions, the genetic relatedness between African languages on the diachronic level, meaning the contemporary African languages and Pharaonic Egyptian and Coptic, but also on the synchronic level, on the horizontal level, all African languages. And as a result, if, for instance, you want and you can make the experience, you want to teach mathematics or science to a young South African from Limpopo who speaks Siswati. You don't have the book in Siswati. If you have the book in Shangaan, spoken on the other part of the Limpopo. I was told by Prof. I learned that it's the Libombo Mountains, it comes from Limpopo, so in Mozambique, or in isiZulu, or in Siswati or in Tshivenda, that child will struggle less to comprehend, to understand science than if the book is in English or Portuguese or French. This is a reality that has been demonstrated by specialists of cognitive psychology. So all these languages, apart from those two, the Semitic and the Malagasy, and two minority languages, that is the Khoisan and the, we have then the Khoisan and the Berber that are minority, but that are related also to other African languages. And we have all the five families, and any language can be related to one of those. And it can make life easy in the production of didactic materials. So what I've just said is not something that comes from my head. This is a conclusion made by UNESCO and the Association for the Development of Education in Africa. Next. So when we talk of Africa, let us stop calling ourselves Francophones or Lusophones, because we are first and foremost Africophone. We speak an African language. Next. So there is a need for linguistic decolonization. Now, in this area, as in any other area, if you want to be serious, to solve a problem, there are a number of things that you have to do. First, you need to build the institutions and the capacities. You need to allocate the resources, of course, but you need also an enabling regulatory framework, legislation, policies, and et cetera. If you do all of those, you will succeed in linguistic decolonization and bringing responses to other challenges. Next. Okay, then yes, the state. Here I'm not going into it because I've been speaking for now some time and I would not want to bother you. In terms of the kind of state that we need, some are invoking the need for a federalist state. Others are talking of a confederation of states, like the confederation, the Nguni Confederation of Chaka, or inspired by it, or other experiences. Others are thinking of the need to think in terms of regional economic communities, like SADC, to see how SADC can, or East Africa, et cetera. I don't want to enter into the debate. When there are questions, we can debate about it. So all these parts, please, move. Next. Okay, you have different approaches. Du Bois and Nkrumah, who as Marxists, but also Pan-Africanists, especially in the case of Nkrumah, have been invoking, you know, the need to choose continentalism, that is all Africa. But there are others, like Sheikh Anta Diop, who are talking of the need to first unite to build a state at the level of sub-Saharan Africa. So there is a debate in it. And there are other Julius Nyerere, Mwalimu, has also expressed very relevant ideas about it. So I think that somewhere we need to have a discussion on that and find out what is best for us. And in that, I think that the truth relies with vox populi, the voice of the people. But informed people, informed about the consequences of the choices they are going to make. That's one. Secondly, in state building and nation building, within the context of African Africa, there is a whole legacy that generally we turn away from. Why? That is why we are failing. The states that exist in Africa, the 55 states, somehow cannot fulfill all the desiderata and the aspirations of African people. So we have to think, why is it like that? Next, please. I want to come close to the conclusion, please. Next. Okay, Sheikh Anta Diop, I will also come about it, you know, about his position in the economic and cultural base for a federal state in Africa. He develops it, you know, at length, and that is what is reflected in these slides. But I don't want to bother you with it. Let's move. Yeah, privacy of political unity. The problem is that in the case of the OAU and the AU, we have almost 55. I mean, the leader, the African Union. What is it? The commissioner? Is it the commissioner? I think that is the leader of the African Union has 55 bosses or 54 bosses. So there is not. We need supranationality. We need at least a capacity to decide on certain matters. All right. If they don't want, if everybody, every ruler wants to keep its portion of state and of African territory, let us at least unite and give supranational decision making on the social sectors. All those ministers, education, health, transportation, etc. That is a suggestion. Maybe it is not valid, but I think that could be part of the way forward. Next, please. I'm sorry, because I don't want to bother you too much. I think I've been speaking for too long. Next. Yes, next. Yes, issues of borders, we know it, security challenges, yes. Okay, stop here. What we need is a united African states, not a United States of Africa, but a united African states. Prof. Gumede, does that sound familiar? Yes, that is the position of the Pan-Africanist Federal Movement, a united African states. Not only uniting Africans on the continent, but Africans in the diaspora. And believe you me, the diaspora, as we speak, is more ready than the African continent to move forward on that, as well as on the issue of reparations. There is a whole agenda. There is a commission, in the Caribbean, in other parts, that is working on reparations. So reparations is also part of African Renaissance. I don't have time to comment it, but we will come back to it. But talking of reparations is also talking about repatriation, meaning the possibility of Africans from the diaspora to come back and settle in Africa. In Ghana, for instance, as we speak, many of our brothers and sisters from the diaspora have gone citizenship and their passport and they have settled. I think that as we speak, there are more than 5,000 of them. And they come as businessmen, they come as people with knowledge, with expertise, that start contributing to the development of Africa. So the connect between the continent and the diaspora is also part of the requirements for the strategic repositioning of our continent and for African Renaissance as a project of society and civilization. So United African States. Carry on. Yeah, Africa diaspora reconnect. Yeah, with a linkage to the movement for global restorative justice and reparations. Next. Yeah, leadership renewal. Okay, this is a picture of the founding members of Thabo Mbeki African Leadership Institute. Next. Okay, we need to identify a number of young men and women to empower them, to put them in institutions, and to reformat their hearts and mindsets back into self-knowledge, self-love and respect and protagonism, to build not only citizens of tomorrow, but leaders of tomorrow. I think that is one of the aims of institutions like Thabo Mbeki African Leadership Institute, with its limitations, but also its successes. It is part of it. And we need even to build networks of such institutions so that we can exchange notes, program, etc. Next. Yeah. We need also in the area, talking of strategic repositioning of Africa and African Renaissance is about also looking into what happens in the area of knowledge production and application. Here I'm using a formula by Paul Chiambe Zaleza and Adebayo Olukoshi in a very important book, a study on the future of African universities. I think we need to do two things: globalize African scholarship while Africanizing global scholarship. Next, I'm sorry, I have to run. Okay, this is an example. Go back. An example in my course in the module that I teach on introduction to global geostrategy. This is one book on which I insist, because you will be taught about, you know, the, you know, Spikeman, you know, Kielan, you know, et cetera, you name them, you know, the members of the two schools, you know, the Anglo-American, you know, school, you know, and the German school with their representatives, their theories, and et cetera, et cetera. But I mentioned also the contribution of Mwaila Chiebe in this book, L'Afrique face à ses problèmes de sécurité et de défense, published at Présence Africaine, where he criticizes, he demonstrates the limits of Halford Mackinder of the British school. I don't have time to go into details, but in the discussions, we might come back to it next. So Africa in the geopolitics of Mackinder, that's what it is all about. Yeah, next. Come back. Decolonization of knowledge. There are a number of institutions, think tanks, that are spread over the continent and that are contributing to producing new knowledge about us, about the position of Africa. We need to know them. We need to interconnect such institutions, so in order to decolonize knowledge, so globalizing African knowledge. Here in South Africa, you have you know, African Institute of South Africa, Thabo Mbeki, you know, AISA, you know, and other institutes that are trying also to contribute to that in the area of geopolitical thinking. But also, if you go to Cameroon, there is a school led by Dr. Paul Fokam Kamenya, you know, as the leader of the Yaoundé School. There is also the Dakar School, of the Dakar Interdisciplinary School, where we can distinguish, okay, you have different specialities that are represented: economics, anthropology, linguistics, history, etc. You name them, but they are working together, you know, to try and produce knowledge from an interdisciplinary perspective, with two outstanding figures. One is Samir Amin, and the second one is Cheikh Anta Diop. So I will end up with Cheikh Anta Diop. So if you can come to Cheikh Anta Diop, let us say, I think I've spoken about Cheikh Anta Diop. He has produced, Cheikh Anta had the value of his knowledge rests with the fact that he was trained in many disciplines: history, anthropology, philosophy, but he was first and foremost a specialist in nuclear physics. And in that capacity, he established himself, he created, established the Dakar radiocarbon for dating methods, where he was dating archaeological and paleontological artifacts. And that was one of the five most prominent laboratories in the world. Cheikh Anta has contributed to history and historiography by establishing scientifically two theses. The first one is, you can move on. When you see Cheikh Anta Diop or CAD, you can stop. The first one is Africa as cradle of humankind and human civilization. And the second one, the profound unity of Africans beyond diversity. I heard the MC mention the diversity of Africans. Yes, we are diverse. But beyond that diversity, if we look at language, culture, cultural practices. We can say with Mangaliso Robert Sobukwe that Africans, beyond their diversity, are like the leaves of the same branches and the branches of the same tree. So let's move to significance. That is my concluding remarks. Significance, sorry. Oh yes, come back, please. Okay, move. Okay. In 1974 in Cairo, there was a scientific colloquium to write the 8 then volumes of a general history of Africa. And Shehanta was invited as a member of the scientific committee. Now, anybody who is somebody who is knowledgeable in the area of historiography, in the area of writing history, paleontologists, archaeologists, historians, linguists, et cetera, were there in the world. And this is the conclusion, the general conclusion of the report written by somebody who was one of the adversaries who was opposing Sheikh Anta Diop. He wrote the report and he had to write this. Although the preparatory working paper, see appendix 3, page 135, sent out by UNESCO gave particulars of what was desired, not all participants had prepared communications comparable with the painstakingly researched contributions of Professors Sheikh Anta Diop and Obenga. And as a consequence, there was a real lack of balance in the discussions, meaning that such an important scientific gathering was dominated by two African scientists, Sheikh Anta Diop and Obenga. I'm saying this and I'm insisting because tomorrow you will hear some people who will never stop criticizing and trying to, you know, to diminish the value, the scientific value. But this is a work that is based on interdisciplinary science. I don't have time to comment it or to explain it, but that is what makes the weight of the knowledge produced by Sheikh Anta Diop and Théophile Obenga. And actually, he has created, he has inspired others. Those who have spoken here, I think that they have also spoken, you know, about Sheikh Anta Diop. Danu Nabudere, you know, peace, may he rest in peace, you know, and others. Maulana Ron Karenga, as you name them, and many others. So that is the school of Africology. Africology as an alternative paradigm for knowledge production and application that is also informed by inter and transdisciplinarity. You know, today it is very fashionable to talk about transdisciplinarity in academic circles. And the reference is the manifesto of transdisciplinarity by Basarab Nicolescu, isn't it, Prof? Generally. Now, Sheikh Anta Diop, before that, almost half a century before, was not speaking of transdisciplinarity or interdisciplinarity. He was practicing it. So once again, you know, the value of his scientific contributions. Next. But Sheikh Anta Diop, you know, these are related to research teams, but I wanted to stop when you see a living legacy, you can stop. Good, a living legacy. There is a journal, it's one example. I've spoken of the other authors, and analysts and writers, historians, anthropologists, linguists, etc. But there is also ANC Journal of Egyptology and African Civilizations. Very, very, very serious. It's also an interdisciplinary team. And in I see that you have been very polite and you want to stop me, but I'm going to stop. I'm going to stop. In the first issue of this journal that has been published since February 1992, there is an article, a study, which is a presentation of the laser ammophont invented by two sons of Sheikh Anta Diop, biological sons, Sheikh Mbake and Samori Kandas Diop, which is a computer software program for the composition of hieroglyphic text on Macintosh computers. But there is also another very interesting presentation of a study that later was published as a book, a summary by its author, Cameroonian physicist Jean-Paul Mbelek, of his book published in 1991 under the title of Photon and Graviton, Incompleteness of the Equations of Electrodynamics and Gravitation. Next. Mbelek proposes in his book a reformulation of the Rutherford-Soddy axiomatic law on the disintegration of radioactive nucleuses with implications in the areas of nuclear physics, radioactivity theory, and cosmochronology, particularly for the determination of the age of the solar system and the study of nuclear synthesis processes in the stars. He succeeds also in recapturing and reintroducing in modern knowledge and thinking the concept of moon, which is the materia prima. You know, it is a hieroglyph that is a design written as an egg. And actually in other African languages, noon and nen is the same. You know, in my language, nen is, you know, is exactly the egg. So a living legacy. Next, I'm going to conclude. Next. Okay, the significance for Africa Day, yes. It's the day, this is a recap of what we have spoken about, what is Africa Day all about, then what need we do, what need we to do? Next. No, next, come. No. No, you are moving too fast. I'm concluding, sorry. Please, allow me, please. Okay, yes. No, stop. The past one that, no. Okay, anyway, significance of Africa Day. Next, we need to integrate all that we have spoken in our educational systems for the emergence of new African citizens and leaders, to celebrate our achievements together with the richest hours and immortal figures, the heroines and the heroes of our history, our victories, Isandlwana, you know about it, Adwa in Ethiopia, Verchier, which was the decisive battle for the independence of Haiti, Ngorongoro in Senegal against the French colonial troops. We need also a calendar of celebration, a Pan-African calendar, in addition or instead of some of the calendars. Now we need to visit on Africa Day and to plan to visit places of memory, meditation, and prayer like the Citadel in Haiti. This was built in the mountain in Cap Haïtien between 1804 and 1820, clandestinely. You have here walls in the mountain. It is part of the facies of the mountain. You have walls that are more than 40 meters high, that are defended by batteries of cannons that have been either wrestled away from defeated French generals or imported clandestinely from Europe and reassembled. And those batteries of cannons did not serve very much because the first boats that tried to come were met by fire. So I think that this is one of the places that we also need to put in our program for our children to visit. Next. Yes, next. African and the interlocutors. I will conclude with that. I've spoken about some of the military victories we have had facing adversity, colonialism, etc. This is not only in the closest times, but since antiquity, it has been the case. I will give an example quoted by Herodot, who is considered as the father of Greek history. And Herodot has studied the different conflicts between the competing peoples, you know, that were living around the Mediterranean, the Egyptians, of course, the Greeks, the Persians, etc., etc. Now, at some point, the Persian king Cambyses had the project to go and conquer the Nile Valley, that is Ethiopia. So this is, it's Herodot who is quoting. This is advice given by the sovereign of black people to the sovereign of the Persians. The day when the Persians will be able to bend bows the size of our bows, then they could undertake to attack us. For now, they should be grateful to the gods for not inspiring to the sovereign of black people any the least intention to add any other lands to his own lands. With that, I want to thank you for your attention. I'm sorry it has been long, but I hope that the talk did address the essential. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Prof. We really appreciate it. It was historical, educational, detailed and detailed and detailed. In conclusion, thanks a lot. So we're going to proceed with our program. It's a little bit still longer. I'm going to request the two program directors that are going to take over from here. Being Ms. Cebile Mahalabe, as well as Uletu Xolo Tlope, to come forward. When they come forward, our choir will just sing probably one verse and they sit down so the colleagues can proceed. We're pressed for time. Over to you. The choir, you can shoot.
Yeah. Emachobo engobiyan bombolega machobo engobiyan bombolega emachobo engobiyan emachobo engobiyan bombolega machobo.
Oh, friend of mine. Oh, friend of mine. What was that now?
This is a wonderful song. It's how we introduce ourselves. This is how my forefathers, when they were busy down there, they would sing the songs just to enjoy.
Why were they singing the songs?
Just to enjoy. Just like how you are doing amapiano these days.
How, my friend?
But it used to be the amapiano.
Are you serious?
Yes.
But it doesn't sound like they get down like we do right now.
No. My God, it sounds so prosper. Not like what you're doing today, but let's continue with what we're here for today.
Oh, hi, Kem Ganam. It's fine then. Anyway, it's World Africa Day. It's okay.
Yebo.
Welcome to every... Okay. They're telling me how to hold my mic. They said here, like this. All right. Good afternoon to everyone. My name is Tebile Ngwakamahalabe Sibongo. Welcome today. I have my co-MC here. He'll introduce himself. Welcome to the World Africa Day event.
Chovicho. Madam Vice Chancellor, members of MENCO, and all your protocols. I greet you all. My name is Kenny Letukolo Wagashope. If I was introducing myself, ngendlela yasekhaya bengitothi ngingihlophe ngimabhe ngisamela lo You did not hear me.
I don't want
you to make noise because I want you to understand the things.
We were given a task today to come and represent our students and our fellow societies that we have in the school. We will be announcing the various countries that are going to come and present here for us. And yeah, my friend, you can just take over.
Yeah, that we have this countries that we have. I am just going to borrow something from Prof. Samba here. When he was speaking, he said, his cousin, who was a politician, he used to say that I will first allow my assistant to speak first. So myself also, I won't say a lot about these countries. I will just allow them to come first. After they have done what they are here for, then I will also put more on what they don't know, because I'm very learned. I know everything. So yeah, at this moment, I would like to call Rwanda. They know what they are going to do here. We just clap for them. They come in front.
Well,
you know, might have been good to us. Despite our internal issues and wars due to this increasing kingdom, she has been able to provide us with good land, growth, and weather.
Yeah. I shall tell you something.
What is it? I heard there are foreign people who are trying to use trade to expand their influence upon our mother.
Yeah, that worries me. Their expansion can be too good. I mean, it's contradictory with our kingdom. They do not exhibit any of our values, and for some reason, mother doesn't see that as worrisome.
These people, like, they possess weapons, not just any weapons, dangerous weapons of advanced technology, and they call it civilization.
Hawema, civilization. These people are up to something. We must warn mother.
We should.
In fact, let's go warn her. Let's go warn mother.
Don't tell me you're all going.
No. After such a nice presentation, you know.
I mean, right?
Yeah.
Must be so heavy. Fertile land, warm weather, and abundant resources. Do you think Africa can help our war-stricken world, cold and struggling with diseases?
You mean mother? She selflessly gives in abundance. She's known for abundance.
By mother, you mean Africa?
Yes, gentlemen, if you may excuse me.
So that is who we need, Africa. With her abundant resources, children, and wealth, we will rule this world. Oh, I mean, we will civilize this world.
Cheers, Porto.
This is a problem.
My children, you lot look worried. What seems to be the matter?
Hey, yes, ma. Hey. These people, these Europeans, English, Zingese people, they're coming with this thing of expanding foreign forces upon us. Hey, ma'am, now I'm worried. They possess deadly weapons. We fear that they are up to no good.
What are you on about now, child?
Mother, as Singer illustrated, these people possess weapons of mass destruction. They are from a war-stricken world. Mother, these people are up to something, and we are afraid they're gonna hurt us and hurt you too.
But then if they are from war-stricken worlds, as you claim, doesn't that mean we should help them? I mean, we have more than enough resources to cater to their world and to ours.
Hey, yes, mother.
And besides, if these people are really as bad as you claim and they really want to hurt me, then you as my children shall protect me, right?
Yes, mother. Right, Nzinga?
Hey. Yes, I mean, yes, mother. We will protect you with all that we have.
Oh, hello, Europe.
Hello, dude.
No!
We're flourishing. You see, my friend, this is what I call hard work in democracy. This would have happened without you, my friend.
Yes, what do they call me? They don't call me capital for nothing.
No.
Yes, we're flourishing.
We demand you to free us and let go of our mother.
What? We are civilizing you, don't you get it? This is for the best. You said you need democracy and technology and to be saved from the barbaric dark ages as a group. So we felt it our burden to do so.
Look, we can share if we give mama the chance to give us everything.
Shut up, you. You fed all your mother in all the dominion disposal, but you didn't utilize it. You didn't build civilization. You didn't build anything in her. So she's better off with us.
Better off
who
we didn't abuse her, we used her for the benefits of our society.
This one is a
common! I am not coming! Just don't care about us!
She now values democracy. If you all say we will impose sanctions from you.
Yeah.
We were never born.
Yes. Yes. She'll be kept democratic. Mother! Mother! Sorry! Zina! Amina! Amina! Zina!
How could they? I'm useless. I shall be known as a dark continent. I shall be known for poverty, instability, barbarism, and crime. And you shall be known as uncivilized people. No. We never existed before they found us. They are better than us. They are civilized. They have been chosen by God, the one true God. Oh, hail Europe.
Mother, no!
Mother, wait! Mother, no, stop! Remember who you are. You gave birth to the first humanity. You are Africa.
I'll go to prepare a place for you. 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 That's when I'm gonna stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home. Far across the river, can you hear freedom calling? Calling me to answer, I'm gonna keep on keeping on.
Murakoze. From Rwanda, is there anyone who's coming to present? Please quickly do so. Yeah, I request that you come, all of you, at the same time, so that after the presentation, then the other one who's supposed to do the rest will do. Thank you.
Can you please start the song? You can start the song.
And gentlemen, the UMP Drama Society presents the beautiful Rwanda,
the land of a thousand hills. Stay tuned and enjoy.
Rwanda. Rwanda has for the past few years been attracting the world's attention, defying the odds and all the stereotypes that exist about African states. Despite still being one of the poorest countries in the continent, Rwanda has made considerable strides and achievements. Currently, it's one of the fastest growing economies in the continent, hosting the cleanest city in the continent, which is Kigali, low corruption levels, one of the safest countries for tourists in Africa, and amongst other things, a very inspirational story. However, this has not always been Rwanda.
For outsiders, it is easy to forget that Rwanda experienced one of the most devastating genocides in the 20th century. With all the latest developments, if it were not for the memorials, you could probably travel the country without ever knowing. The story of Rwanda, as fantastic as it sounds to people outside of Rwanda, is one that must be spoken with delicate words. The events of the genocide are still horrific to the people of Rwanda, so much so that tourists are not allowed to ask Rwandans about their ethnicity, which is said to be one of the reasons why the genocide occurred in the first place, taking the lives of 800,000 human beings. However, the genocide, as painful as it was and still is to Rwandans, does not begin to structure the rich history of Rwanda. After the First World War, Belgium took over Rwanda as its colony. Like any other colonial superpower on the African continent at the time, Belgium had a powerful strategy to maintain control over the people it deemed its property: divide and conquer. The emphasis on ethnic differences among Rwandans was further enforced by Belgium. Belgium divided people who shared not only a language, but a culture. People had been intermarrying for generations, but at some point, because of Belgium, they were now enemies. In 1962, Rwanda becomes an independent state. However, the ethnic tensions continue, and they lead to the unfortunate events of 1994, the genocide.
However, even after the dark, horrific history, the sun still honored its rising. Building Rwanda, those events were so devastating that the entire country was almost wiped out. The public, as well as the judicial infrastructure, was almost non-existent, with only one functioning court left in 1994. This left Rwandans with absolutely no choice but to work very hard to rebuild their country, to work towards social cohesion, reconciliation, and unity of the people of Rwanda. According to the World Bank, Rwanda has pulled more than 1 million Rwandan citizens out of poverty from 2005 to 2017. The past few years before COVID-19 saw Rwanda being among the fastest growing economies in the continent, with a plus 7% GDP growth annually. The Rwandan government has its eyes in making Rwanda the hub for technology innovation and growth in the African continent. And so far, it has not disappointed. The stride Rwanda has made when it comes to investing in science and technology has resulted in significant outputs. And this involves Rwanda becoming the first country in the world to use drone technology to deliver medicine to its citizens living in the rural areas. This became significantly important during the COVID-19 outbreak. Secondly, Rwanda recently launched Africa's first Fourth Industrial Revolution Center. Last but not least, Rwanda launched its first ever satellite called RuaSat in November 2019. This has helped thousands of rural Rwandan school learners to be able to connect to the internet.
When it comes to nation building, one of the most amazing things about Rwanda's attempt to promote social cohesion and unity is that their activities also address other issues. For instance, Umuganda. This is a national holiday taking place on the last Saturday of every month for mandatory nationwide community work from 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. Even the president of Rwanda takes part of this mandatory project. It is for this reason that Rwanda is renowned for its cleanliness compared to other African states. Why should you visit Rwanda?
Thank you.
Rwanda is located just south of the equator and is one of the smallest countries in Africa. It is surrounded by Uganda, the Democratic Republic of Congo, Burundi, and Tanzania. Rwanda is a mountainous country located on the far western edge of the Rift Valley. Nyanza, this is the administrative capital of the southern province. Nyanza is the eighth largest city in Rwanda. The main attraction of the region lies in its cultural heritage, which undoubtedly merits a stopover en route to Nyungwe National Park. World worth a visit is the King's Palace, a reconstruction of the traditional royal residence, a beautifully crafted, thatched dwelling shaped like a beehive. At the back lives a few long-horned Angole cattle, descended from the king's herd, whose keepers carefully tend and sing to them. Nyungwe National Park is one of the oldest rainforests in Africa, rich in biodiversity and spectacularly beautiful. The mountainous region is teeming with wildlife, including a small population of chimpanzees as well as 12 other species of primates, including gorillas.
Thank you very much. That was Rwanda. Thank you very much. Kupaliba shapen matoho. Yes. Dumelang Basutu. Yeah. Thank you very much. So now we are welcoming the ones who are representing Lesotho. And I'm hoping that, as I have said, that there won't be any space in between if you are doing whatever that you are doing. Please come, all of you, be closer, or you're gonna stand with us here, I don't know. But just make it a way that you finish everything without leaving a space in between. Thank you.
Ah, le sele amohetse. Jolo ke le tlhaisa ka pela lona se tlhopha sa Lesotho. Ke tla le tlhaisa ka nelane ya Lesotho. Lesotho, the inland country. Le fase la dithabathaba. Le fase la bomoshweshwe. The Kingdom of Lesotho was established by Moshoeshoe in 1822. Moshoeshoe e ne le botapele ya papatsehang. A ile nga tsha setshaba se sesho ho tswa ho ditlhopha tse nyinyane. Le ba papatsehi ho tloana kong e di faqane Afrika Borwa. Ka puso ya Lesotho. The rule of Moshoeshoe was from 1822 till 1868. The British Empire took over in 1869 till 1966. The Kingdom of Lesotho received its independence here on the 4th of October, 1966 from United Kingdoms. Morena ba Lesotho ha jwale ke morena letsie wa boraro. Kahana ba lefase la Lesotho. Di percente tsa masoma a robedi. E naha ya Lesotho ke dithaba. Ka maemo a lehodimo a mabe. Make the percentage of a sum of perifela. A cause of reason for agricultural development. The extremely skewed distribution of arable land explains the exclusive population concentration in the western cultivatable areas. The population of Lesotho is about 2 million. The white settlers, when they happened to arrive in Lesotho, they made it illegal for white settlers to buy grains from Basotho, which resulted to them importing grains from Europe. The measure brought down the regional prices of grain. The currency of Lesotho is well known as Maluti. Kahami Seveti, known as Chops. The scarcity of jobs and land shortage forced many Basotho people to move into South Africa as migrant laborers. It was estimated in the 1995 that over 25% of the added male labor force was employed in the South African mining industry. Languages. Tsana hae rona e botse ya Lesotho. Ke dipuo tse di pedi molaong Lesotho. Ke Senyesemane, known as English, le Sesotho. Although Sebuting and Xhosa are also widely spoken, and they are in the process, kgotsa ke re mothating wa ho etswa semmuso. Naha ya Lesotho e motlotlo ka meetlo le mafa yone a fapaneng. Lesotho e arohanye ka di-district tse lesome. Hare ha tsona re na le Beria, Buthabuthe, Leribe, Mafete, Moseru, Mohalehooks, Mokotlo, Kakashnek, Kuting, Thabaseka. Lesotho affiliation. Lesotho is associated with United Nations, Commonwealth, African Union, le sadeke ka bophara ka ha di mineral resource di ra fuatsa le sotho kili kili taimani le metsi ka ho Afrika Borwa e fumana metsi a mangata le sotho ka moroho wa Highlands Water Project. Are kene ka tsa economy. The economy of Lesotho is based on subsistence farming. Basotho ba itlwaetsa ho lema dijo le ho rua mehlape a lekaneng malapa a bone e seng molemong wa phaelo. Ka tsa thuto ka ha Lesotho, all 6 to 13 year olds must attend primary school for 7 years. The law was implemented in 2010. National University of Lesotho, which was established in 1945, has approximately 2,000 to 2,999 students enrolled with the university for the post-secondary education. Chale, chamanyekenyeke. Chemang le mang a ratang go di taste. Ba re jo ka sekgowa. Mefuta ya dijo tsa Lesotho tsa go ja ke Basotho. Re re tshwaretse ka morago nyekwe. Mokopu le dinawa le mabele di re dira tshenyekwe. Sekitsa, pufo e sekolotsweng e le mokopu o lapitsweng. Sekele, mokopu wa lephutsi o sa ukulweng le tla fumana le diphaphatha ka mane ka morago potelo re bolela ka bogobe bo sekolotsweng le morogo di be di pheletswe mmogo lehwapa dihwapa bildong someone's favorite nama a jo ang a ile a omisiwa ka pele pele e tla lwiwa re na le mokomate gape le tse dinga tse ngata tse di sa feleleng tse e leng gore di na le baši ba tsona ke tla o beela ka tlhogo e jake banna ba dutse kgotla ka tšee di ka diang batho gore ba rate go etela naga ya rena ya Lesotho ka sengesemane ba re ke tourism Sahlanyane National Park ke bontle ba Lesotho ga se mang le mang a ka ratang go etela a se fitlhe gona ka Sedaman Botanical Garden. Any trip to Lesotho is highlighted by a visit to Katsani Dam. Trust me, you don't want to miss it. Sunny Paws and the highest pub in Africa. Those militant and vibrant youth of Africa, they always make it a point when they visit Lesotho. They go for hiking, mountain biking. That's the place to visit. Hajwale kitswala kasimokong falls. Asida felela. Didingata fela hanga qala le kabala subela letsatsi. Hajwale ke le hlaisetsa moaparo wa basadi ba Lesotho. Hajwale ke seketlo hape le halena. Jwale ke le hlaisetsa motseko wa basadi ba Lesotho. Ke re mogiba we. Jolo ke le hlaisetsa ho lona seruki sa rona o leng hore mang le mang ka hare ha lona ka rata ho tshwana le yena ke ba ha o mole bohe
ya Afrika ke matla ho fetsa me ntse ele me bala bala allow not they destroy our cultures manong asinang sitso. Oh Africa, my inspiration, proud should we be to be Africans mahore lokela ho ema ho etsa Afrika. Africa, for the development of Africa lies in our hands.
Jwale ka he re lisia lisiana o hlahloba le ho latswa dijo tsa rona le teleta fola ka mane ka morao mang le mang ke a tshepisa o tlatswa a itatswa melong le menwana jwao.
Give them a round of applause again. Thank you very much. Our next country, is home to the world's largest desert known as the Sahara Desert in Africa. Our next country is Morocco. Morocco, please take this to the stage.
Hear me roar from the north of Africa, the barbarian lion in the dry bellies of the earth. My tongue tingles as my mouth waters to the aroma of the couscous dish. Morocco, dressed in royalty with gold, covered by the skies, cobalt blue. Wounded from the harsh drought, bright red, and blending with nature, emerald green. I carve not only the henna tattoos on my skin with pride, I carve the art of beauty with wood and steel. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Ahmed of Morocco. Travelers, allow me to usher you into the world of Berbers and Arabs. And here we are, in the city of markets, the city of trades, the city of money, the city of diversity. Behold, the city of fairs.
I am a city that homes wanderers and merchants, harboring immigrants of Spain and Tunisia, roots of volubles composed by Arab warriors. I am the killer of loneliness. No second passes without a human breath gracing my grounds. At my heart, there is Medina, my oldest yet thriving. Second best doesn't always mean worst. My streets are small, twisting, and confusing. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, I am Fez, the second of Morocco.
Come here, my people, for you have now been acquainted with the city of Fez. Now shall we journey to the city of fashion, the city of glamour, the city of music and art, the city of Marrakesh.
This soul is the beauty of the soil. It breathes the rhythms creating seasons. Behind this, we define the beauty of the city of Marrakesh.
Did you hear that?
I mean, listen again. I mean, listen to the sounds of the beauty of Marrakesh, the city of Marrakesh. Its valleys is without shade. It's like a big peach without pollution.
This air is clear. Just breathe.
As the sun sets, the star settles. The star is born in Morocco.
The flag of Africa was added.
Thank you.
See, you have now familiarized yourselves with the city of art, the city of music, and on we journey to the imperial city of tradition, religion, and culture, the city of Magnus.
All hail, King Sultan Moulay Ismail, with the biggest of smiles. Allow us to walk you through the miles. What's mine minus what's none might pile up the renowned flair of Magnus. The prestige of the ominous king shall beg you to kneel. The prestige of the ominous king shall beg you to kneel. Take a moment. Breathe the breeze of Magnus to a satisfactory degree. The scenes of Clisa shall reveal the secrets of the living queens. Take a moment. Breathe the breeze of Magnus to a satisfactory degree. Allow Bob El Manso to take you through the greatest crafts of the Roman architecture. Let us paint your picture the Magnus way. Let us paint your picture the Magnus way with the flamboyance of the core embellishment. Let us paint your pictures the Magnus way. Allow Bob El Manso to take you through the greatest crafts of the Roman architecture. Witness love roaming around. Roses crying all their beauty with joy and pride. Almost as if India had the touch of honor. Merahes, Mreba, Ermeknes, Elahim, Saklakir.
Travelers, behold, you are now familiar with the country of Morocco, and it is our honor to show to you how we dance in Morocco.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Morocco, and your whole living room. Thank you very much. the next country that we have is among the most resource-rich countries on the planet, with an abundance of gold, titanium, and all minerals used in electronics, such as cell phones and laptops, and we utilize them every day. The next country we have is the DRC.
Thank you.
na beno. Mbote na biso. Mbote na biso. Mbote na beno. J'aimerais à télé, mais mon groupe de DRC, comme close our guys, I need your DRC.
We welcome you as the DRC, the Democratic Republic of Congo. We take pride of our country. Now let me take you through the DRC. Our country, DRC, is situated in the central of Africa. It is the second largest country in Africa, followed by Algeria. In our country, we have exceptional natural resources, including minerals such as cobalt, copper, diamond, hydropower potential, significant arable land. Can I breathe in? Our country, DRC, is situated in the central of Africa. It is one of the biggest countries in Africa, followed by Algeria. In our country, we have exceptional natural resources, including minerals such as cobalt, copper, hydropower. Hydropower potential, significant arable land, and we have the world's largest rainforest. DRC was previously known as Zaire, named by Mobutu. During the First Congo War, Rwanda invaded our country and he named it Zaire. But came 1997, where Laurent Desire Kabibi took power and renamed our country the Democratic Republic of Congo. In our country, we have five national languages. French is the official language widely used in education and government. Now, I'm going to teach you how to greet in these languages. In French, we say bonjour. In Kikongo, we say mbotenapini. In Lilanga, we say yamboyenu. Hello in Chilumbu is moyiwenu. Now, I'm going to pass it over to Seth, who is going to deal with our culture.
In DRC, we have a lot of culture, and which the focus on one culture, which is Luba culture. Where is Luba culture located? Luba culture is located in central of the DRC, which is Kasai Oriental and Kasai Occidental. We speak Kiluba and Luba of Katanga, and we believe in the generation of ancestry, and being a tribute of spirit. One of examples of our culture, our Chiluba culture, is Bantu Bonso Badi Balejiwa Ne Badi Nemakokeshi Abu Badi Nebakwezelangana Badi Nelungani Wabu Muntu Nekando Kamoyi Badi Nebakwezelangana Malubu Mubu Wetu, which is means all human beings are born free and equal in the dignity and rights under which with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in the spirit of brotherhood. I will pass over to Lebu. Thank you.
The education system in our country is governed by three government ministries. The education primary in our country is not free or compulsory, even though our Congolese institution says it should be. Ladies and gentlemen, I repeat, even though our Congolese institution says it should be. As violence at and around at schools is a known barrier to access, we create school environments that are safe and conducive to learning for every individual. Our country is widely considered one of the richest country in our world because of natural resources, because of its untapped deposit of raw minerals.
Ladies and gentlemen, despite such vast minerals, the economy of our country has drastically declined since mid-1980 due to exploitation, disease, and wars. Our country is a Feed the Future aligned country. We have the USAID Agricultural Assistant, which focuses on livelihood development and improving households' income so that poor communities are more stable and are able to participate in the market. With our culture, our beautiful natural resources, our arable land that has Mount Staley, we would encourage you to visit our country and witness the beauty of it. Ladies and gentlemen, we remain proud of our country. We remain proud of our country. Ladies and gentlemen, merci, au revoir.
Thank you so much.
Merci beaucoup. Au revoir. À la prochaine.
Merci.
Asante DRC. If you're still not interested in visiting any of these countries, the problem just lies within you. It has nothing to do with the countries. At this moment, I am thinking that we should go for a trip as a university, but I'm not sure who's gonna pay. I'm just not sure who's gonna pay. But all of us, there should be a trip. All of us, we are going to visit all of them. What's it, Patalabani? Sector Shangana. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I am introducing another country now. This one has something in common with EDRC. I'm sure they will outline it. I don't like Mine Kuluma before people, they do what they are supposed to do, because I think they're already prepared. And when I say it now, they have to limit some of the things. So I'm just saying, Senegal, come and show us flames. We are yours.
The country in which we have chosen and we were given was Senegal. We are from the gender-based violence society, and this is the country we were given. The area that we all know as Senegal was part of the West African Empire of Mali, Ghana, and Dakar. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide. The country takes its name from the river that runs along its northern and eastern borders, forming the frontier with Mauritania and Mali. The Republic of Senegal became independent in the 1960s. And after three centuries of French colonial ruling, Dakar is the capital since independence in the 1960s, lies on the Cape Verdean Peninsula, the most westernly point in Africa. Before independence, Dakar was the capital of French Western Africa, which was the AOF. Political culture. Next slide. Okay. For over 40 years, the Socialist Party, the SP, has been our principal party until March 2000. Thereafter, the Senegalese Democratic Party, the SDP, and opposing leaders took over for over 25 years. Next slide. Okay. Senegal has a cultural tradition made beautiful by its people. French is the official language, although the native languages are Wolof, Pula, Dila, and Mandingo are spoken as well. Most of the Senegalese population practices Islam, and about 6% still practice indigenous religions. These are a few of our ethnic groups that are in Senegal. There are over 20, and those are the percentages. Again, on to the next slide. With that said, the food and customs at ceremonial occasions. On ceremonial occasions, festive meals that include roasted or grilled meat with beans or French fries are eaten. Kosher steamed millet with vegetables, mutton, and gravy is a ceremonial dish. At the end of each meal, strong and sweet tea is drunk. Except in areas where it's prohibited, alcohol is available. Our basic economy. The country's market economy is based largely on agriculture. The limited economic growth it has achieved since independence is interrupted periodically by drought conditions that can send the economy into severe recession. The most important food crops are millet and sorghum. Large quantities of rice are imported into the country. Cotton, sugar, and market garden produce are grown. The national currency in the country is CFA, which CFA franc. The trades in which we have are peanuts, cotton, and fish, as well as fishing products are exported out of our country. Fishing products, mostly canned tuna, provide directly and indirectly employment for mostly 150,000 people in our country. As part of our next slide, please. Thank you. As part of our diversification policy, Senegal became one of the first African countries to develop tourism as major national economic activity. Our exported products that we have are peanuts, cotton, fish, as well as fishing products. Next slide, please. Although we have tourism as well, Senegal became one of the first African countries to develop tourism as a major national economic activity. However, tourism suffered a major blow from the Casamance insurgency and the conflict with Mauritania. Yes. Cash crops, including rice, kopis, maize, sugar, and livestock. Cement, refined sugar, fertilized, and tobacco products are exported to neighboring countries as well. Food, capital goods, and petroleum are imported from France, Nigeria, Algeria, China, and Japan. Next slide. Because we are from the gender-based forum, we included gender roles and statuses. A division of the labor by gender. Women generally do most of the household chores of cooking, cleaning, and childbearing. With the growing exodus of young men from the villages, rural women have become increasingly involved in managing village forestries, resources, and operating millet and rice mills. The government has established a rural development agency designed to organize village women and involve more men to develop more actively in the development process. Women play a prominent role in the village health committees and prenatal and postnatal programs. In urban areas, despite women's second-class status in Islam, change its processes rapidly in big cities, where women have entered the labor market as secretaries, typists, sales clerks, maids, and unskilled workers. Our higher education, we have a lot more varsities in our country. The sector is divided into four levels, of which two are mandatory. The sector is divided into pre-primary, at least for 1 year between the ages of 5 and 6, elementary for 6 years between the ages of 6 and 11, lower secondary for 4 years between the ages of 12 and 15. Thereafter, our kids can go to higher education. As a member of the Economic Community of West African States, the ECOWAS, and the West African Economic and Monetary Union, Senegal has always played an important role in regional integration in West Africa. The bank has supported the country's steps towards regional integration. One of the pillars of the bank's long-term strategies from 2013 to 2022, and the financial US $204 million in operations in the areas of transportation, energy, higher education, and the environment. Thank you. From now, I'll give it over to my fellow members.
We teach young girls to dance, and they're pulling them in one at a time to do it.
Visit Senegal. Besides its harsh circumstances, it has proven to thrive within these difficult situations. They celebrate their ethnicity through their culture and food, as you have seen, with the Sabada dance and this lively Diola dance, which is from the Casamance religion region of Senegal. So with these dances, it is actually done in memory of its ancestors to also bring peace within the land and chase away the witches, as well as not to forget their sweet and amazingly delicious, worldly renowned dishes, such as the jollof rice, talipa fish, and ankara. Although their economic activity is not as strong as other African countries, it has actually proven to maintain its levels of social cohesion, mechanical solidarity, as well as peace and love within their society. So, who wouldn't want to visit such a vibrant and spirit-filled place? You are not only invited to indulge, you're not only invited to explore, but indulge. Thank you.
Thank you for Senegal. Our last country that will present for us is Kenya. And before they come on stage, I'd just like to say Kunjaba or Hujaba. Okay, I'm not good at it. I was just saying hello, okay? But thank you. Kenya, you can come to the stage.
I'm here to represent the Kenyan group, as you can see. It's a nice one.
Yeah.
I'm going to take you on the brief history of the Kenyan culture, whereby initially it wasn't Kenya. It was known as the East African country at the coastline of Indian Ocean. And the first settlers on that area were the Cushitic or the Ethiopian-speaking people from the northern parts of Africa around the 2000 BC. By the first century AD, the Kenyan coast was visited often by the Arab traders, who, due to the Arabian Peninsula, established colonies there. Thereafter, the Neolithic and the Bantu cultures started to spread and settle there. Also, under the colonial history, this culture or the Kenyan evolved from the mixture of the Bantu Arabic, as I've already highlighted in the previous slides. And this is where the Swahili language was developed as a trade language and between different people. We've got two languages in Kenya. We've got Swahili and also the English. The East Africa was then divided into territories under the influence of the European rulers. Also, as time goes on, the white settlers had the power to participate in the section where they started to cultivate the land. And during that era, thousands of Indians were brought into Kenya to work on the building the Kenya-Uganda Railway, which is where they end up settling them. Then, the resistance to colonialism, which is the Mau Mau. This is a group that was formulated by the Kenyans as they didn't tolerate living under pressure or as slaves or working for the European leaders. And then different tribes like Kikuyu, the Emba, the Meru, and the Kamba, they united together to fight the British colonialism. The Mau Mau movement that took long period was then later resolved. Leaders such as Jomo Kenyatta in 1953 was sentenced. And then after he was followed by Dedan Kimathi, who was also arrested, but later was hanged by the colonies. At a later stage, the Kenya did manage to achieve independence around the 1957, where the first elections for Africans for the Legislature Council took place. And those who were elected, they increased in number, and then they supported the release of the previous leader who was strong and powerful, Jomo Kenyatta, and he was released from detention. Around 1962, the Kenyatta was released and became the first prime minister of the Kenya, and then Kenya gained the independence on the 12th December 1963. Then the following year, it became the Republic with the Kenyatta as its first president. Kenya today, Uhuru Kenyatta, which is the son of John Kenyatta, is currently the president. Major industries happening in Kenya include agriculture, whereby crops such as the cowpeas, they are preferred as staple food, especially for poor families. And also forestry, it is rich in forestry, the fishing, the energy and tourism. Interesting facts about Kenya. Thank you. Kenya is rich in tribes, tribes such as the Kikuyu, the Luhya, and the Maasai. Yeah. The attire, as you see, this clothes that I'm working, Lana, it represents the sugar. This is what it called by its name, the sugar. And the red color represents the bravery. Also, at the back, the second table from the right, we've got our food table where meals such as nyama choma is prepared, the mirenda, the omena, the ugali, the chips and munyai. And also the drinks that they prefer in Kenya are the Mabele brewed drinks. And then now I'm here to present to you the Kenyan dance. Ladies and gentlemen, here you go.
Malaika, na upenda malaika.
Can you please give them a round of applause again? Yes, 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 yes. Oh, all right. Thank you. Thank you to all the kanjis, everyone that presented. Right now, we're going to allow our judges to go and taste the food in the various stalls. And then thereafter, can we have our senior program director come and take over? Thank you very much. Thank you. And we have a song for now. Kenya, Kenya. Thank you.
Thank you.